visited Copenhagen, it was a number of years ago now. I took my 20 kroner and city bike and I cycled out to see the icon of Copenhagen so that I knew I was definitely here. And of course, what I saw were some rocks. That's better. I think it keeps me free-handed. So the reason I've shown you this is because these icons or images that we get, and the other smell, the sounds, tell us where we are. They give us a sense of where we are in the city or where we are in the world. They make us feel safe or make us feel uncomfortable, whatever they do. So when we're designing sports facilities or spaces for people to be active, we have to take that into account, that your environment plays a huge role in that. And sometimes we have to be creative and sometimes to be inventive and so on in the way we look at these. And the most notable examples of inventive sports facilities or innovative ideas come from major sports events. And the Olympic Games are a classic example. And of course, Beijing's bird's nest, the water cube, you know, they're iconic. You see them, you know it's Beijing. You don't need a sign telling you what it is. It was there, they were inspirational. The question about Beijing, I think, is whether this is sustainable, because the legacy has not been worked out. Whether they will be used as sports facilities and for the betterment of sport in China is a big question. London has taken a different approach, and in designing its stadium, which is always the big question, what do you do with the stadium afterwards? They've thought about legacy in advance, because London doesn't need another big stadium long term. And I'm going to show this video, I hope, that will show how London is tackling that in quite a creative and inventive way. We're building a big stadium, but 55,000 of the 80,000 seats are temporary and they will go away afterwards. And this video should explain how that happens.
Stage in our journey to the Olympic and the Paralympic Games in London in 2012. And I will never tire of saying that. The Olympic spirit is about finding the best in ourselves. London 2012 will be that and more. Thank you.
the challenges for London, apart from building that stadium, which they're well underway, is to get the legacy that they hope, and that is about inspiring the youth of the world to be more active. So we can come to the next slide. At a much smaller scale, the Commonwealth Games, which are going to Glasgow in 2014, the stadium was again an issue, because Glasgow already has three stadia, all with a capacity in excess of 50,000 for spectators, so they don't need another stadium. We used the Celtic Park, Celtic probably well known to people, as for the opening ceremony. Again, a change with tradition, because normally the opening ceremony and the athletics in the same stadium. We've taken the opening ceremony out of the main stadium. Ibrox, the home of Rangers Football Club, will host the Rugby Sevens. And Hampden, a national football stadium for the athletics. And Hampden's quite good in that it has this bowl shape, so it's ready made for athletics. The problem is that the width, the length and the width are not quite big enough for a modern athletics stadium for a major games. So the idea that we've come up with and will implement, and again, as far as we know, it's never been done anywhere before, is to build a platform 1.5 metres above the existing pitch level. It takes out about 6,000 seats, but it gives a capacity of 46,000. The Commonwealth Games, 40,000 is the minimum, so we're well within that. And afterwards, we're going to convert it back to the football stadium, but that's still an awful lot more cost-effective than building a stadium that we then have no use for afterwards. The other advantage of Hampden is that it's got tunnels that go right into the field of play here and here. They're connected with a road underneath, and the warm-up track will be here, so it's really good connection. It makes it a good stadium. And in 2014, it'll look something like this. And just one other thing to point out about the Commonwealth Games that are different from the Olympic Games, apart from the scale, and we think it's a positive thing, is that events for para-athletes and para-sports are actually integrated into the programme. It's not a separate programme. So if you go along to athletics, you can see a wheelchair race along with the 400-metre hurdles immediately after that or whatever. So it's very much an integrated. But it does mean that when you're planning the stadium, you have to think about access and all the issues that disabled people have, which can only be a good thing. So spectators, often not thought about much at these events other than to sell them tickets and get them to turn up. But they like to be involved. They want to add colour to the event. And of course, the spectators at the event are only a fraction of those that watch on TV. And the challenge is, how do you get those people who watch sport to play sport? And that's what games, part of the legacy, should be. It is a challenge, but all the research has shown that immediately after a game, participation goes up, and then after a few years, it just goes back to where it was before, which is something that's how you sustain that increase in participation. So it's about legacy. The next Olympic Games, of course, are the Winter Olympics next year in Vancouver and Whistler, and the Oval in Richmond will host the speed skating. But the legacy is already happening. The building's complete. It's in use and multi-use. It hasn't been designed solely as a speed skating venue. It will have